So you probably use numbers for things like balancing a checkbook or computing some sales numbers or something like that. But you can use it for physics. So let me do a simple example. Well, maybe it's not so simple. It's going to be calculating orbits. So let's start with a blank spreadsheet here. And in this spreadsheet, I'm going to create columns here. Let's get rid of the left header there. Let's put a satellite at position X and Y, where X equals 0 and Y equals 0 are the center of this whole thing. In other words, the center of the planet that the satellite is orbiting. So let's start off with the satellite is to the right of the planet. So here's the planet, right? And let's do a small satellite that is going to be just off to the right like there. So that's going to be X equals, let's come up with something like 100 and Y equals 0. The Y coordinate's the same as the planet. X is over to the right. So the planet looks like it might be, you know, a certain radius of 50 or something like that. But the actual R we're going to use is going to be the distance from the center of the satellite to the center of the planet. So to calculate the distance, we need to do Pythagorean's theorem, which is going to be the square root of the sum of the squares. So the X coordinate to the power of 2 plus the Y coordinate to the power of 2, square root of the whole thing. So you can see the distance from the center to the center is 100, which is what you would expect with X being 100 and Y being 0. So now let's create a velocity, because if this thing's going to be in orbit, it's got to be moving. So we'll do dx and dy. And let's say what would make sense at this point is that the satellite is moving this way, right? Because gravity is pulling it here. The satellite's got to be moving this way in order to orbit. So we'll do dx of 0 and a dy of 10 as a starting value. So straight down. The acceleration, though, is going to be towards the center of the planet. The planet is pulling it there. Let's go and shrink this table a little bit by selecting the entire thing. We don't need columns to be so big. And let's add another column there. Let's do the acceleration because of gravity is going to be a formula where it's equal to a gravitational constant divided by, and we'll do the gravitational constant as 1, divided by the distance squared. So power of the distance to the center squared. And that gets us a number like that. Now, the constant could be anything, and we're not using units here. This 100 is not 100 kilometers, miles, nothing. We're going to skip units to keep this simple. So a gravitational constant that would work really well at a radius of 100 would be 100 squared. So you could find this through experimentation, or because I happen to know this, I can put that in there. So that's the gravitational constant. Now if you want to get the acceleration in the x direction and the acceleration in the y direction, what you need to do is that's equal to the acceleration and that's multiplied by the x coordinate divided by the total distance there. And the acceleration for y is the acceleration multiplied by the y coordinate times the total distance. Now there's one adjustment we need to make. These need to be negative because it's pulling towards, not pushing away. So let's just put a negative there. Great. So now let's calculate the new acceleration here, which is going to be equal to the old one, right, plus ax. Right, dx plus ax. And this is going to be equal to the old one, dy plus ay. That's the new amount. Now given that, the new x coordinate is equal to the old x coordinate plus the difference in x. And the new y coordinate is equal to the old y coordinate plus difference in y. Now the radius you can copy and paste and it will show you that it's approximately the same, a little bit smaller. The acceleration is based on the radius, so we can put that in there. And this is based on the radius and the acceleration due to gravity. We paste those in there. That's the new amount. I can copy and paste these throughout the entire thing here. So this is what I get. And I can tell already that I've got a radius here that starts at 100 and it gets closer and then starts to actually get a little further away. So what could we do to illustrate what is happening here? Let's create a scatter chart. I'll take these two columns, the X and Y position. I'll create a new chart. Choose scatter. I've got it right here. Let's go into the axes here. And we're starting at a radius of about 100. So let's change the scale to be the maximum of 200 and the minimum of negative 200. That's in X. Same thing for Y. There we go. We also want to go and make this a square chart so I can see that the width and the height are about the same. So we can see what's happening here. So we start here at X equals 100 and Y equals 0. And then we go like this. That looks good. That looks like an orbit. Let's stretch this table a lot more. And you can see it fills in with all the data. And now I can look and see I've got a circular orbit. How did I get a circular orbit? Well, I cheated. I knew that the answer would be this here. This is the speed, right? 0 in dx and 10 in dy. I filled that in with a value of 10. Look what happens if I fill in with a value of 12. It creates an elliptical orbit here. This is 0, 0. I can actually move the planet, this shape here, right to 0, 0. There we go. And you can see what's happening here. If I change it back to 10, you can see it's a nice orbit. If I change it to 13, you can see it actually looks like it escapes. It may actually, if I had enough more space here, it may actually orbit in a very elliptical way. If I decrease, you can see it actually goes inside the planet here. Of course, I'm just giving it arbitrary size for the planet, so I could shrink this down, you know, certainly to some sort of more normal size like that, and put these at the center of each other. So, you know, depending upon the radius of the planet, this could be an elliptical orbit, or it could be a crash and burn orbit. You could even see here that things get to go out of shape as the satellite is going to continue to get closer and closer to the planet. So you can use this to compute orbits. Another cool thing that you could do is you can create another chart that is for R here. So you could do that, do a line, and you could see the altitude here with, you know, it's starting here and in this elliptic orbit it gets really high and far away and then gets really close again. If I were to go back to a normal speed, you could see it, but this is, I mean, this goes from 90 to 110. To be fair, I should actually do a scale of 0 to 100. Sorry, let's try that again. The X, Y, the maximum of 100, minimum of 0. There we go, 110. So you can see it actually kind of stays in a somewhat stable orbit. Why, if this number is the right number, the dy, does it kind of go a little bit elliptical like that? Well, that's because we're taking these big time steps here. If we had smaller steps in between, then I would assume that this number would smooth out. And if you had really tiny steps, you would end up with 100s all the way down here. But it's just because we're jumping from one step to the other, as the dots show, that it's kind of like losing a little bit. And then it gets it back as the same error, you know, little bits of error are repeated. And it stays at an average distance of 100. So there's kind of a fun science thing that you could do with numbers, and showing that you can do more than just accounting and bookkeeping with it.